This is the Norris Group's Real Estate Investor Radio Show, the award-winning show dedicated to thought leaders shaping the real estate industry and local experts revealing their insider tips to succeed in an ever-changing real estate market. Hosted by author, investor, and hard money lender, Bruce Norris.
Hey, everybody. It's Aaron Norris and Bruce Norris in studio with Steve PonTell and Gregory Bradbard. Steve is the CEO and president of the National Community Renaissance, or National CORE, which is one of the largest affordable housing developers in the U.S., based right here out of Rancho Cucamonga in Southern California. The acquisition developer and social services nonprofit controls over 10,000 doors and close to $1 billion in assets while housing over 27,000 residents in four different states. In 1996, Steven founded the La Jolla Institute, a California-based nonprofit think tank that advances better understanding of the critical elements necessary for both community and corporations to achieve sustainable economic competitiveness. Gregory Bradbard is the Senior Vice President of National CORE and the President of Hope Through Housing Foundation. He's got 20 years of experience as a community leader and a fundraiser. Prior to joining Hope Through Housing and National CORE, Greg served as President and Chief Executive Officer at the Inland Empire United Way. Well, welcome, Greg and Steve, to the show. Let's start first with National CORE, how you got in the business, and how did we even get started here?
So this is National CORE's 26th year. We got started as SoCal Housing when redevelopment agencies had a responsibility for providing affordable housing, but really didn't know what to do. There was an organization in Northern California known as Bridge Housing, and so SoCal Housing was created to be the bridge of Southern California. So began working with cities early on, and started to help solve some of the affordable housing problems in Rancho Cucamonga, Rialto, and we've grown from there. About a dozen years ago, I decided to go national, and so they created a sister organization that expanded nationally, and then about 6 years ago, decided to go ahead and merge them both into one organization again. And so now we're in California, Arkansas, Texas, and Florida, continuing to look at national opportunities, but about 80% of our work is in Southern California.
Why did you pick those states?
At the time, they went national, and I've been with National CORE for 6.5 years. And so at the time they made the decision to go national, they bought a number of portfolios. And so the states were determined by the location of the properties they bought. But they're the logical contiguous states of California, Arkansas, Texas, and Florida.
Yeah, exactly.
My hope is to add Maine and Alaska, and then we have all four corners covered, and we're good to go.
National CORE is separate from the foundation. What was the strategy behind that, and why is it set up that way?
You know, one of the challenges we have is, you know, National CORE is a developer and a general contractor and a property manager, and also provides social services. The funding that we get does not adequately fund the social services that we want to provide. So one example would be, you know, we have approval for after-school programs 2 days a week, but we need them 5 days a week. And so then we have to raise the money for those additional 3 days a week. And so creating the Hope Through Housing Foundation gave us a vehicle by which we could raise the funds necessary to support the social services that we need to provide for the benefit of our residents. Do you want to add anything to that, Greg? Or?
Yeah, you know, I'll just share a little bit about Hope Through Housing. You know, one of the things that I love about the National CORE Hope Through Housing model and partnership is that it's about so much more than just providing safe, stable housing for families and for seniors, but instead really using the housing as a platform to create life transformation. And that's really where I see Hope Through Housing coming in, is it's that partnership with those that already are living on the sites, providing whatever it is for the kids, for the adults, for the seniors, to make sure that we're improving both their well-being, their physical health, their mental health, but then also their economic stability and their long-term sustainability. And for the kids in particular, really our mission is to break the cycle of poverty. And we want to do that by helping prepare those kids for future self-sufficiency.
Is there a standard sort of size of the property you guys specialize in? Is it a large apartment building, small?
Well, it used to be. We used to, you know, our goal was always to do something over 100 units. It's getting more and more difficult. So we've actually done a couple of 19-unit projects recently. Most of our projects now are now in the 65 to 100 unit space. Although, as of yesterday, we were notified that We're being recommended for a cap and trade grant under the whole strategic growth initiative for 184 units in San Bernardino. And so we got a $20 million grant that's going to be voted on by the end of this month. So that'll be a larger project.
Congratulations.
It's pretty exciting.
Wow. So cap and trade, we're talking about energy credits here. Exactly. Are you building LEED certified buildings? Is that what that means?
Well, we build LEED certified buildings anyway, but the cap and trade, when they put it in place, there was a certain amount of money that was allocated for affordable housing, you know, under the logic that distressed communities, communities that need, are often the most disadvantaged environmentally. And so they did believe that having adequate housing is a critical environmental initiative. And so a certain percentage of the money is put out throughout the state of California, a couple hundred million dollars this year for affordable housing projects. And so we're the only project being funded this round in the Inland Empire.
Well, the genesis real quick of this interview is we're doing a series based on a question by one of our real estate investors. What do counties and cities want to see from smaller infill projects? You guys are obviously huge, but I serve on the board of 211 Community Connect. So since I've been on the board, housing and homelessness has been the top issue. So
absolutely,
30% of the calls that we take have to do with housing and homelessness. And that's how I met Greg and ultimately you. We had a conference and funny, I was trying to convince Steve to come on the panel and he's like, oh gosh, not another panel, like they're all the same, and it, you know, it's just probably a broken record. And you said something very, I've been putting together panels of real estate experts for over a decade, so you said the most interesting thing I've ever heard. You said, I would like to get somebody in education and somebody in sustainability there. And maybe you should explain what you told me and why.
Sure. First of all, how long have you been on the board of 211?
7 years.
And you haven't solved the problem yet? Is there something you're waiting for or what? So here's the challenge that I think that, you know, as a housing developer, we have to come to realize is, you know, it is true that people care about housing, but they care about health more than housing. And it is true that they care about housing, but they care about education more than housing. And people care about housing, but they care about the environment more than housing. And so one of the things for people to understand is one of the most critical determinants of health is housing. And so people that are not, this is not complicated, but being homeless is not a very healthy lifestyle. People that live in overcrowded conditions, it's probably the single largest public health crisis facing the future of California. Kids cannot perform as well educationally if they don't have adequate housing. If they don't have places to study, places to be able to focus, it makes it very hard. And tens of thousands of children are living in overcrowded circumstances. The state of California is 1.5 million housing units short last year, according to the State Department of Finance. And if you care about the environment, you would care that people are adequately housed. Because at the end of the day, people care about the environment to the extent they can afford to care about the environment. And if people don't have food, shelter, basic human needs, their caring about the environment is very, very low. So if you were in the conversation we had, if you were a true environmentalist, you would be out there fighting for every housing development you could get so people could be adequately housed so that we would have the resources and the ability to protect the environment that we want to protect. And so that's one of the areas where I have cognitive dissonance. The opposition that we get for housing development from those people that say they're for the environment, I find completely disingenuous.
So you probably weren't a big fan of the rules that just came down about solar having to be on every house in 2020.
Well, it goes back to every idea is a good idea. But at some point, somebody has to say, at what cost? And at the end of the day, if housing affordability is the most critical issue facing California right now, why would you want to mandate additional cost? And so thinking through the cumulative effect of everything, fire sprinklers are a great idea. Garages are a great idea. Back doors are a great idea. You know, and so the question, though, is, you know, there are certain cities that are taking, you know, looking at fees for public art. Great idea. But every fee adds to the ability to provide housing. And when you're already in a hole, at some point you have to stop digging and count the cost.
Is there any benefit when you're building as a nonprofit? Do you get out of any of the fees? I was just at a seminar last week that had industrial, commercial, residential builders there. And I think it was somewhere around 28% of the project's cost now at this point on average across the country has something to do with regulation. Is that on average sort of what you're seeing, and do you get out of any of it because you're a nonprofit?
No. The only thing that we get out of is we can get a welfare exemption for property taxes. But as far as developer fees, all the development processes, all the mitigations, we pay 100% of all that.
Are you notice those are all going up now that they're no longer making money on foreclosures and fining banks?
Well, the answer is yes, but there are really two halves of that equation. So the fees are the easiest part to quantify. But one of the conversations we have is, look, cities, you need to count the total cost, the cost of process, the cost of time, the cost of mitigation, the cost of uncertainty, the cost of litigation. Because we would say, let's say we pay $100,000 a door in fees, we probably pay another $100,000 a door in process. And yet cities don't think that that's real cost.
Right.
And you know, if you're in a pipeline for 5 years getting a project through, the carry cost on that money is a real cost. If you have to go to 7 design review or planning commission meetings and then do redesigns every step of the way, those are real costs. And so at the end of the day, this is not calculus. This is not algebra. This is pretty basic math. And we believe cities should count the cost and understand the total costs that are put on and then make some decisions and say, okay, we want to limit the costs that we're putting on a project in order to be able to see the production of housing units that are more affordable.
Okay. Well, things have changed quite a bit in the last 10 years, and especially in the state of California where you specialize in with redevelopment dollars. So can you tell sort of how that's changed the process, where the money is coming from or not coming from anymore?
So redevelopment was putting about $1 billion a year into affordable housing. So we're 6.5 years later, $6.5 billion removed the affordable housing industry, which is about 60% of all the dollars that were available in California, California-specific dollars. There's still federal dollars, which are a different category. And so what the state has started doing over the last years, and the cap and trade is an example of that, about $200 million a year coming from cap and trade for affordable housing. There's a bond on the ballot. So there is money that's being added to the system, but it's not a fraction of what it was. And what is happening is the dollars that are being added to the system are targeting narrower and narrower slices of the population with higher levels of acuity. So we're under construction in San Diego right now where half the units are targeted for chronically homeless, which is a category, veterans, which is a category, with AIDS. So that's a very slim slice of the population.
Oh, you're saying all three of those have
all
to be
three,
met? To
correct.
How big is the project?
It's 60 units. 30 of the units would be targeting that population.
Wow.
And then I think they also have to have puppies and be, at the end of the day, that's the direction the funding's going, is towards narrower slices. And the challenge for us is, how do we create a community blending together these different populations of needs as we try and layer the funding together necessary to do a project?
I was looking on your website with all the different funding sources, and I had not even heard about half of them. I'm like, oh, I didn't know you get money from there. And I was wondering if it was still around, or if at the same time it's getting very political where regulation is coming down from the state. We want this. We want this. Well, put your money where your mouth is. Is it disappearing?
Yeah, we have to look very hard on some of the sources of funding where the strings that are attached to it cost more than the money that's available. And so that's a constant balance for us as well. It's interesting for us, and we'll see what happens with the next governor. The presumptive gubernatorial winner has been talking about reinstituting redevelopment. We'll see what that looks like. But the biggest problem we have in California is there's not enough money on the planet to build subsidized housing for everybody that needs housing. Until we can get the market to produce market rate housing that median income earners can afford, that we're never going to get there. The distortions are going to continue to be significant. And one of the biggest problems we have is the market is massively distorted, which is why we need more and more subsidy to produce the units for those people in significant need. There will always be segments of the population that need help, that society, I believe, has an obligation to help. But the bulk of the population should have product available, shelter choices available that they can afford, especially if you're earning the median income. And yet the housing units being produced are significantly more expensive than median income earners can afford. And so until we get that market distortion worked out, there's not enough money on the planet to build the housing units that are necessary.
You've got seniors that are deciding to stay in place because of sometimes tax benefits. They can't afford to move on to the next location. And so you don't have seniors selling houses and then affordability crisis. It's sort of landing all at one time.
What price point in California would be the number you think is needed?
Well, it's variable by county. So if the median income in San Mateo County is $60,000, And then let's say you're not supposed to spend more than 30% of your income. So $20,000 a year for housing. And so $20,000 a year either for rent or mortgage. And so, $1,500 a month for a family of four for either rent or a mortgage payment would be the goal.
The payment.
Mm-hmm. And so then, Orange County, LA County, et cetera, would be a little bit different. And so that would be something we should constantly be monitoring. At the peak of the last run-up, 2007-08, we were to the point where only 14% of the population could afford to buy a median-priced house. So that's how much the cost of housing had risen. Now we're to the point where I think we're somewhere between 30%, 30 to 40% of the population can afford a median-priced house, but we're continuing to trend back to where we were last during the last run-up.
Yeah, and I'd add, even on the rental market side, we know that almost half of renters are paying, they're rent burdened. We know to afford the median rent today, you have to earn essentially 2.5 to 3 times the minimum wage. Or if you have a single parent, let's say, who's supporting a couple kids, they'd have to have 2.5 to 3 full-time minimum wage jobs in order to afford that rent.
What is the circumstance where people need affordable housing? I mean, is it one parent, or is there an autistic child, or what's the background of how the people come into need?
So they fall into a couple of primary categories. So number one is seniors. The senior tsunami is real huge, and we are so underhoused for our senior population that exists today and that is coming. That I think is a huge societal wake-up call. And especially for those seniors that want to age in place in their community where their friends and churches and everything are, their alternatives are increasingly limited. So seniors is a big component. The vast majority of affordable housing that we have is called workforce housing. And so for it's the working poor. So it's people that earn anywhere from 30, 40, 50, up to 60% of the median income. So we talked about median income, and it's not 60, but let's say it's 60,000 in San Mario County, then 60% of that, or $36,000 a year. So a family earning $36,000 a year, that would be a part of the population that we'd be serving in workforce housing. So these are the working poor that need places to live. And then you have an entire array of special needs, whether it is developmentally disabled, autistic. We have an amazing property that if you ever have the opportunity to tour in Montclair called San Emmy for developmentally disabled adults. And I mean, it's a magical place how, living in community and supporting each other and working. And, there is a population that will need help and, how we put that together. Other categories include transitional assistant youth. So foster kids aging out of the foster program that don't have places to go. 85% of foster kids end up being homeless. And once again, as a society, I think that's unconscionable. And so, the population I mentioned earlier, the chronically homeless veterans with AIDS. So you can just look at all these different categories. They either have physical issues, mental health issues, other kinds of disabilities that require a certain amount of support. So those would be the three major categories: seniors, working families, and then various aspects of disabilities.
Going out 5 years from a project's first being fully occupied, what percentage do you think would be the same occupants after 5 years?
Huge disincentives for families to move out of our properties, because if you have not had stable housing and then you get stable housing, you will do a lot to keep your stable housing, including not accept a promotion, not take a new job, because when they do the math on, wait a minute, I have to now go try and find a market rate house based on a new job that I don't know it's going to last versus the stability I have living in this community at this income and the job that I currently have. So the disincentives for families to move out are huge. And the disincentives for developers to have families move out are also huge. Nobody pays us to help families move out of our properties. Turns cost money, costs a lot of money and energy to coach families, financial literacy, language issues, other challenges that they're having in order for them to be successful. We believe in it passionately, though. So we view our properties as launching pads, not landing pads. And so a lot of what we do is to try and figure out how we can work with families to help them move out.
So, you know, we actually just recently launched a new program, which we call Pathways to Economic Empowerment. And it really, it is focused on exactly what we were just talking about. And it is, I mentioned before, breaking the cycle of poverty, but really it's about the long term. So it's one thing if we look at a family today and say, hey, look, you have affordable housing. This works for you. Don't need the promotion, the whole thing. Just stay where you are. But if really what we want to do is change the future generationally, means we need to look beyond that. And we know that one of the best ways to make that happen is through home ownership. If we can help our residents to move out of our housing into home ownership, we understand the asset that it builds for that family. Any of us as homeowners understand that, where that provides stability. It can put kids through college. It provides long-term the asset and stability. So Pathways is a one-on-one financial coaching model where we have a one-on-one financial coach, and she meets with the residents and helps dig into what their income looks like, what their expenses look like, their spending patterns, helps them set some personal goals, and then a household budget, which a lot of these families have never had before. And our goal is really focused on four different things: increasing their income through employment, decreasing their debt, increasing their credit score, and then increasing their short and long-term savings. And what that does is it also prepares them for the long-term and potentially for home ownership. And I'll tell you, we actually launched this with a series of first-time homebuyer workshops. And I was interested to see who showed up. And I went into the first workshop. It was in our Villaggio property on Foothill in Rancho Cucamonga. It's an upstairs conference room. There was literally a line out the door. And we had 50 families that were packed into this room. You could barely breathe because it was so warm in there. But that showed me immediately, we have families, even in affordable housing, who want this. They want to get ahead. They want the best for their kids. They see the benefit long term, and they're willing to make the sacrifices to get there. And so we're excited about that. And I'll tell you, even in the 6 months, we just launched this in January, we're hearing some incredible stories of residents who had high interest loans. They used check cashing services. They've now refinanced those. They're paying down those debts. We're seeing their credit scores go up. And already three of the families that we're working with have been pre-approved for home loans and are moving in that direction. So there are some promising practices.
And so to answer your question, about 5 years is probably about the median time people live in our properties. But some live there for generations, and others, we really help them move out more quickly.
Is there inventory on the other side of that? Are you working with partnerships with Habitat for Humanities or cities begging for you to be like, we'll help you any way we can?
I wish they were begging, but no. But we do have partnerships. So we're working with a lot of banks, lenders, Habitat for Humanity, others like that. So one of the things we do is we have a lot of those partnerships. So we're watching for those programs. As you might know, there are quite a few home buyer assistance programs that help with down payments and that kind of thing. I will say a challenge is, though, just as we were just talking about, just the cost of housing, getting them to a place where they can afford a home, even in San Bernardino County, is challenging. So one of the things we've seen is those families that are used to, say, a community that might have a higher standard of living, higher incomes there, more difficult for them to adjust if they go, hey, look, I'm going to need to move a couple of towns over where the house costs might be less. But it's quite a change for them in terms of what they're used to. It also means moving their kids to some different schools.
Yeah, that's probably not as fun as, yeah, that's a little stressful.
No, absolutely.
I didn't even think it was going to take this turn. Do you work with any real estate investor groups that are more focused on infill properties and putting cities and investors together to sort of bridge that gap? Because I know right now it's harder for real estate investors to find value, say, on the MLS or finding inventory. So we're having a lot more conversations about creating value by building, adding accessory dwelling units. Is they're not a space for that yet?
Well, I would say, you know, we're not working in that space specifically right now, but it would definitely be something that we'd be interested in, you know, building those partnerships and looking at what the possibilities are there.
Okay.
Yeah, the primary, I mean, one of the ways we can solve the housing crisis in Southern California is through accessory dwelling units. If you just look at Vancouver, British Columbia, about 30% of the single family homes have accessory dwelling units. If we had in Southern California, it's somewhere around 1-2%. If we got to 20% single-family homes with accessory dwelling units, we'd solve the housing crisis. But we are working with market-rate developers on infill multifamily projects that have an affordable requirement. And so we're working in a variety of areas around Southern California where you have market-rate and affordable going in together, and we're bringing the affordable part of that equation.
Lived in New York City for 7 years, so, and I lived in some very interesting areas. One of them was it was next to one of the projects, which had a horrible reputation. And I think that New York frowns upon that period of time that they set things up the way that they did. And I knew as an artist in New York, the new thing was they were working with developers to set aside a specific amount of affordable units of a part of regular, like in the middle of Times Square, as an example, you know, they would set aside a few, and it was a lottery kind of system. Is that seen to be sort of the most popular?
Yeah, it's one of the solutions. One of the things that we do is I would challenge anybody to just randomly drive around and try and find one of our projects, because our projects are indistinguishable from market rate projects. And so the era of quote unquote public housing, the projects, et cetera, is pretty much over. Most affordable housing is exactly the same as market rate housing.
For more information on hard money loans and upcoming events with the Norris Group, check out thenorrisgroup.com. For information on passive investing with trust deeds, visit tngtrustdeeds.com.